natural to be separated like this, but I just want to say welcome, friends, to the May 6th joint meeting of the Rotary Clubs of Louisville and Lexington. I'm Julie Schmidt, president of the Louisville Club, and I also serve as senior director of external affairs for KET. Please give a warm welcome to the podium, my good friend and yours, Bill Wilson, who's president-elect of the Rotary Club of Lexington. Bill?
All this here.
If everyone could also mute, please. Thank you.
You can eat the whole thing.
Can everyone please mute the lines? Thank you.
Okay, am I on now?
You're on. Go, Bill.
Okay. Well, thank you, Julie, for this opportunity to collaborate with the Louisville Club. We think it's a special blessing. You know, 2020 was supposed to be considered a very interesting year, and indeed it was. But through it all, like you indicated earlier, we learned some new things. One is how to collaborate electronically. We also learned that we had to rethink the way that we delivered services to our communities. But through it all, I think we were strengthened. I think we gained new friendships, and we've even been able to acquire some new members through it all. And thinking in terms of a virtual activity, we've got a great one coming up on May the 8th at 7 o'clock. We're Dancing with the Stars. And this is an opportunity for us to do a little fundraising as well. Well, my name is Bill Wilson. As Julie indicated, I'm president-elect, and I'm sitting in for our servant leader, Jamie Schrader, who was not able to be with us today, but of course he sends his best wishes. And although Jamie is not with us, I do have some special guests that I'd like to introduce to you today. We have our district governor-elect, Michael Norsker, from the Rotary Club of Somerset. And we've been told that we have members from the Cynthiana Club, the Moorhead Club, the Florence Club, the Somerset Club, the Hazard Club, the Frankfurt Club have all joined in today, in addition to all the Rotarians from 6740. So we're just delighted to be here. Julie, it's really good seeing you again. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Bill. It's so good to be with you and all your friends and Rotary Club of Lexington. And we also have some special guests to welcome. And from District 6710, we have some of our leaders, and that's Joanne Hepperman, who's our district governor, Nancy Stearman, district governor-elect, and past district governor, Otha Ray Stearman. Guest of Susan Cepeda, Charlotte Beeson, who's the former executive director of Kentucky Board of Nursing and Commission on Collegiate Nursing Education. And we, again, just want to welcome everyone here today. We're so excited to be joined together. To provide our invocation is Kevin Lynch. He's Senior Financial Advisor of RG Financial Group, and he chairs the Rotary Club's Investment Committee and is also a Paul Harris Fellow. Please welcome Kevin.
Thank you, Julie. Dear Lord, thanks for bringing us together today. It's been a tough year facing challenges with COVID and legitimate tensions from racial inequity that came to light. There are signs that we're starting to turn the corner on COVID, and it feels like spring is in the air. The excitement of the Derby last weekend, spring weather, vaccinations taking hold. But let's use good judgment on how we re-engage in the community. I want to give thanks to Governor Beshear for his leadership during this time to prevent it from getting much worse. Help us come out of this stronger and wiser. Don't waste a crisis. We've been separated for a long time, which is not natural for us. We're social animals by nature. Help us appreciate the importance of nurturing relationships and spending time with friends and loved ones. Give us empathy, Lord. We've seen others have suffered more during the pandemic. We understand how African-Americans often don't have the opportunities that we simply take for granted. Dear Lord, help us do our part to help others and to reduce inequity in any way we can. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Now to lead us in the pledge and the four-way test is Walt Kunau, who's president-elect of our club. He's president-elect designee. Walt also chairs the Rotary Promise Scholars Committee. He's a recipient of the Rotarian of the Year Award, and he's also a Paul Harris Fellow. Walt, welcome.
I'm honored to be able to do this today. Before I do that, I do want to have a couple of recognitions. First, Dan Blosser, that you're going to hear from in just a minute, is the music director at Christ Church United Methodist, where I worship, and you're in for a real treat. And then I also want to say hello to Governor Andy. We're fellow Commodores, anchor down. Join me, Rotarians. What do you pledge? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now let us recite the four-way test of the things that we think, say, and do. Is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? Thank you.
Thank you, Walt. And as he just shared, we are absolutely delighted to have special music today in honor of our speakers. Dr. Daniel Glosser is the Director of Music Ministries at Christ Church United Methodist of Louisville, and he'll be singing God Bless America. Please welcome Dan. Up our spirits. We so appreciate your being with us today and for blessing us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all so much.
Now, welcome back to the podium, President-elect Bill Wilson, to introduce our first featured speaker. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you. Daniel Boone once proclaimed that heaven must be a Kentucky kind of place. Now, Daniel Boone knew then what we all know now, and that is Kentucky is a special place. Of course, we have our bourbon, we have our horse racing, we have our outdoor recreational activities, we have our historical cultural venues, we have our bluegrass and other music genre, we have great Southern cooking, and we have our arts and crafts. All of these things more or less comprise Kentucky's portfolio of tourism assets. But one of the additional assets we have in Kentucky is Secretary of Tourism, Arts, and Heritage, Secretary Michael Berry. He was appointed by Governor Beshear, and prior to his appointment, Berry served as the president and CEO of the Kentucky Derby Festival. And under his 22 years of leadership, the Kentucky Derby Festival orchestrated the award-winning two-week celebration for over 1.5 million attendees annually, generating an economic impact of approximately $128 million for Kentucky. Now, Secretary Berry has his hands full because tourism is one of the top three industries in Kentucky. In 2019 alone, visitors spent approximately $8 billion in Kentucky. Now, I could go on and on and talking about Secretary Berry's accomplishments, the awards that he's won, but now it's time to hear from Secretary Berry himself. So fellow Rotarians, please join me in welcoming the Secretary of Tourism, Arts, and Heritage, Secretary Michael E. Berry.
Thank you, Bill. I appreciate that introduction. Good to see everybody today. This is a whole new world. Obviously, when I was doing this, I've spoken to your group before in the big ballroom at the Golf House and when everybody was there together. And I just commend you all on being able to continue the camaraderie and the service of Rotarians, even though we have to be separated for the time being. But even that is coming to an end, and we're going to hear a lot about that from the governor. I was just kind of scrolling through the list of the 193 participants. That's a big wow. And I've noticed some names that are so familiar from my days of working in Louisville, some from tourism across the Commonwealth. I even saw somebody that was a fraternity brother in college. So there are all kinds of folks on here, and I hope that they're as excited as I am to talk a little bit about my first love, and that is what Kentucky has to offer, not only to people who are from outside the Commonwealth, but to those folks like me who are lifelong Kentuckians that haven't quite seen everything yet. You know, when I took this job, when I retired at the Derby Festival on the 1st of October, 2019, and I was retired for 10 whole weeks, and the governor called, and he probably offered me the only job that I would have come out of retirement for, and that was to lead the tourism effort. And I have to say, you've got to not only believe in your passion, but you have to believe in the boss too. And I'm so excited to be a part of this administration. I'm gonna now share my screen with you. We're gonna do this a little bit by, or we are gonna do it by PowerPoint. So let me make sure I can do this. Here we go. Can you all see that? Okay, and for some reason, I am muted. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're not muted.
Oh, okay. Okay, great. Sorry about that. Okay. So the Kentucky Tourism Arts and Heritage Cabinet is one of approximately 13 cabinets in state government in the executive branch. And everybody thinks, oh, you all are the tourism people, and they come up with state parks usually, and maybe a couple other agencies. But they don't realize the spectrum of our cabinet when you include arts and heritage. So, you know, we work very hard to make Kentucky a premier travel destination, but also to make sure that the arts are something that are appreciated and draw folks into the Commonwealth, and also that we preserve our heritage. So the mission of the Tourism Arts and Heritage Cabinet is to support and promote and develop tourism, arts, and heritage as a mechanism to foster economic growth, education, and employment for our communities. And, you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, does it really create that many jobs? 95,000 jobs across the Commonwealth are created by the tourism industry. So all of this we do while ensuring that Kentucky remains a premier destination, not only the first Saturday in May or the first last 2 weeks of April, but we want to ensure that 52 weeks a year, 365 days a year, and we remember that we also have an audience that is both national and international, but also at home as well. So the cabinet is responsible for, and I'm really impressed by this slide, is responsible for 45 state parks. Now, of those 45 state parks, 17 are the ones that you probably think of because they have the lodges, the resorts, but also some additional 14 historic sites, 13 golf courses. So sometimes I'm a golf course superintendent as well, 34 pools and beaches, 15 marinas, 32 campgrounds, which are all almost totally booked these days, and we'll talk about the reasons for that. 80 horses that we're in charge of, including two former Kentucky Derby winners at the Kentucky Horse Park. Over 1.5 million square feet of event space, and 58 wildlife management areas totaling over 161,000 acres. So where'd all of those come from? Well, we talked about that 1.5 million square feet of event space. Well, that's primarily at the what we call the fairgrounds in Louisville, the Kentucky Exposition Center, Kentucky Venues, and also the Kentucky International Convention Center in downtown Louisville. The Kentucky Horse Park, as I mentioned, retains about 80 horses, including two Kentucky Derby winners. It is an actual working horse farm, and those in the Lexington Bluegrass area know how beautiful it is. We just finished a weekend before last, the Land Rover three-day event. We had to do it without spectators, but it is one of the largest equestrian events and most prestigious, and we were able to have it. And in fact, it was televised on NBC. So that encompasses a park of about 1,200 acres there on it straddles Fayette and Scott counties. In addition to that, if you've ever been to Frankfort and you've gone to the Kentucky History Center, maybe you're into genealogy or whatever, but it is a wonderful museum that teaches classes and individuals all about Kentucky and our background. One of our agencies that's been particularly popular this year, the Department of Fish and Wildlife Resources. They had a record year for fishing and hunting license as people sought to do things out of doors. They manage those wildlife management areas, those 58 of them, and they total over 161,000 acres. You know, that was probably the agency that I was the least knowledgeable about when I came on board, and I thought it was all about catching fish and hunting game. But it's not. It's more about conservation and making sure that those species that are native to Kentucky are there for generations to come. And if you go to these wildlife management areas, if you've ever been to far western Kentucky and seen the elk herds or the bison herds up at Big Bone Lick State Park, you will realize that Kentucky is very responsible when it comes to making sure that our natural resources are going to be around for a long time. The Kentucky Heritage Council, if you have ever been to these neat main streets, whether you're in Williamsburg or Shelbyville or Katy's, Kentucky, and you know, there's this new life, this new revitalization, that's probably through the Kentucky Heritage Council's Main Street program. And a lot of the preservation, historic preservation, is done through and made possible through that agency as well. The Kentucky Center for the Arts in downtown Louisville, home of the Louisville Ballet, the Kentucky Opera, Broadway Across America, the Louisville Orchestra, et cetera, that is an agency of the Tourism Cabinet. And similar to that, the Governor's School for the Arts, the end of June, about 250 young men and women will be on the campus of the University of Kentucky for almost a month in learning how to foster their potential careers in the arts. And all that is made possible through the generosity of state government and administered through our cabinet. And then if you're familiar in downtown Louisville with the African American Heritage Center at 18th and Muhammad Ali, that's another one of our agencies that's dedicated to bringing the history and the culture of the African American community to light, and utilizes a beautiful facility that was the rail, the streetcar hub for all of Louisville back when we had streetcars. So it's just an incredible place that we get to manage and be a part of from one end of the Commonwealth to the other. So I'm not going to bore you with a lot of numbers, but just to tell you, as Bill mentioned when he introduced me, $8 billion with the B dollars in visitor spending. That creates about an $11.8 billion total economic impact. That's tourism, and that's, you know, that generates about $1.5 billion in tax revenue. Arts and culture, that's another $2.3 billion in economic impact. And of course, outdoor recreation, $5.8 billion. And that was a big year and will probably even grow even more this coming year as people look to do things safely out of doors. Honing in on Fayette and Jefferson County, you know, these numbers show you the revenues. And these are 2019 numbers, but this is from lodging and food and beverage and things in the tourism and the hospitality industry. But you look at those bottom numbers, almost $1 million in total economic impact in Fayette County, and I'm sorry, almost $1 billion and over $2 billion in Jefferson County that is generated by tourism. And that's just an incredible number. It is a business. We even got involved in the COVID response efforts. Now you can imagine that the arts and cultural industry and the tourism industry were really hit hard by COVID. Many of the attractions, the indoor ones had to close down. You see the restrictions that have had to be put on restaurants and the way we do business at hotels, et cetera. But we took lemons and we made lemonade. The state parks became very popular as people looked for doing things outdoor, and we left all of the state parks open. We took one of the large halls in the Exposition Center in Louisville and made it into a 2,000 bed makeshift hospital. Thank God it was not needed, but that trauma center was there should the hospitals in Louisville and the surrounding area run out of beds. State parks, some of them before the lodges reopened, were provided temporary housing for first responders, frontline healthcare workers, and low acuity patients to relieve pressure on these hospitals. And then of course, we voted in a different way, especially in the primary election, and the Expo Center and the Center for African American Heritage were all safe and early election day voting sites. And then even currently, Broadbent Arena in Louisville and the All-Tech Arena at the Horse Park in Lexington are serving as vaccination sites, as well as some of our state parks. So I want to share with you, if I can, little 30-second spot of our new campaign, Stay Close, Go Far, Travel Safe. And we're excited about that as well, because this continues our outreach to folks. As you have probably heard quoted before, 2/3 of the nation's population is within a day's drive of Louisville. Our surveys are showing that people are ready to travel, but they want to travel safely. So the road trip is becoming very much of a popular thing once again, and we're well positioned for that. And I know I sound like a broken record, but our outdoor attractions are positioned well for that as well. You know, we're also investing in some areas that we haven't been necessarily as aggressive in before. LGBTQ travel. That is a new area to open up for travel to Kentucky, and also African-American heritage and travel opportunities as well. So we're excited about what the future is going to bring as Kentucky tourism reopens. I'm showing you here the Logstill Distillery, thanks to an effort led by Governor Beshear and some others. This new facility is going to be opening in Nelson County. It'll create 126 jobs and is going to be an incredible tourism draw with lodging and all kinds of amenities that you don't really think of when you think about going to a distillery. We were talking about, I heard somebody talking about App Harvest earlier. Let me share with you real quickly an interview that the governor and Jonathan Webb, the head of App Harvest, did for us recently. We are doing a new series about agritourism. We all know about the importance of agriculture, but you would be surprised how many people come to Kentucky to travel. And while they're here, they go to a working farm or they go to a place like App Harvest. So let me get you started here.
Mike, the sound isn't coming through.
Okay, just a minute. Anything?
Not as of yet.
Reasons, which is, you know,
now it's on.
Collectively, have to figure out how to grow a lot more food with a lot less resources. Our facility.
The audio is pretty muted, Mike. I don't know if there's anything you can do on your end or not. Maybe it's just too many people on the call. I don't know.
Okay. Well, you kind of get the picture there about App Harvest. It's a great place. As one of your attendees said, I don't think they're doing full tours yet, but they will, because it's quite the facility. So I don't want to run into the governor's time. You always got to remember the boss here. But one of the things that I did want to do, people ask me, you know, it's like when you get asked, what's your favorite child? And you say, oh, I love them all equally, even though I love them all differently. Well, I get asked many times, so what are your favorite tourist attractions in Kentucky? And these aren't my favorite, but I think they're must-see because they're different and you may not think about them. So I just want to share this real quickly with your attendees, your viewers. John James Audubon State Park in Henderson. You know, it is an incredible place to go visit. It has one of the largest collections of the works of John James Audubon, including The Birds of America, which is his masterwork. It has a complete series of that and is a salute to when he lived there. Don't forget, at the Kentucky Horse Park in Lexington, it all isn't about the summer and horse events. They do a wonderful event called Southern Lights there. It celebrated its 28th year in 2021, and thousands of families come. It's very safe. You can drive through and enjoy the holiday lights. The Moon Bow at Cumberland Falls, just like a rainbow needs a full sun, when there's a full moon, you get a moon bow. And the next date is May 24th through 28th. You can always visit parks.ky.gov for more information, but you got to see a moon bow. In far western Kentucky, the American Quilter Society Festival will be in April of 2022. If you're not there during April, make sure you stop by the American Quilting Museum that is on the waterfront there. Just beautiful. And then a place that I kind of discovered when I was being a tourist, and that was the National Underground Railroad Museum. They also do a tour. It's in the Maysville, Kentucky area and across the river in Ripley, Ohio. It was here that Harriet Beecher Stowe got her inspiration to write Uncle Tom's Cabin and many of the stops along the Underground Railroad and the history of that emanated there. So I think those are great places for people to see and to visit, along with about a million other places. So I'm going to stop there. It is this week, National Travel and Tourism Week. We've got a couple of videos here from the governor, but you're gonna hear him live. You're hearing me live now. So I know I'm a little pushed for time. Julie, I'll be happy to take questions if there are any, or if we need to scoot right into the 63rd governor of the Commonwealth. We can do that too.
Okay, as soon as we know he's on, we'll go ahead and wrap up. But until then, there are a couple of questions, if you don't mind, Mike. Just really appreciate your leadership and all that you're doing. And I was just curious, the History Center in Frankfort, which is another beautiful historical place that you mentioned a moment ago, but really want to encourage people to go to. Is it open now for attending or school groups?
Yes,
or?
Yes, it is. It is obviously subject to mask mandates, social distancing, and also occupancy requirements, but it is open.
Oh, wonderful. And just again, a big round of applause and appreciation for you and your team for lifting up our Commonwealth and encouraging people to travel from outside and even inside our state. We have such a treasure in our state parks, our historical sites, and so much to offer here in Kentucky. So just thank you again, Mike. Appreciate you and for spending some time with us today.
Thank you. And follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. You can go to our website, all under the Tourism Arts and Heritage Cabinet.
And one last thing, if you could email your clips, people want to see them still. So we'll embed them in a email out to our members. And I'm sure Lexington will as well. So everyone can take a look at those on their own time.
Okay. Who would I send those to, Julie?
You can send them to me. I'll get with you. Yeah, I'll get with you. We'll get them distributed. So again,
By the way, I'm really not at Natural Bridge, but it's the most popular attraction during the summer in Kentucky. So I had to give it some love.
Yes, it's gorgeous. We love seeing it. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Well, it's now my great honor to introduce our governor. Andy Beshear grew up in Central Kentucky, son of Jane and former Governor Steve Beshear. He graduated magna cum laude from Vanderbilt University and earned his law degree from UVA Law School. Prior to entering public office, he worked as an attorney and was a partner at Stites and Harbison Law Firm. His first elected office, he served as Kentucky's Attorney General, where he fought for Kentucky families against the opioid epidemic, focused on child abuse and human trafficking, protecting our seniors from scams, fraud, and abuse, along with many other important issues. In December of 2019, Andy Beshear was sworn into office as the Commonwealth's 63rd governor. As he was beginning his term, one of the worst health crises in our lifetime, the COVID-19 pandemic, struck our state and the nation. And our governor has been dedicated to leading the Commonwealth through this challenging time. Please join me in welcoming to the podium, Governor Andy Beshear. Governor?
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for inviting me to speak with you today. It's been
Governor, I don't mean to interrupt you, but we can't hear you as clearly as we would like.
Okay, one second.
Thank you.
We're working on it as we speak. Okay, how about now? Can you hear
yes,
me?
Yes, perfect. Thank you.
Great. Well, I was just saying first, good afternoon and thanks for having me. It's been tough since I talked to you a year ago. We've learned a lot and learned how to look out for one another and how to slow the spread of this virus. And we have saved countless of lives. Unfortunately, the truth of where we are is the crisis is not yet over and our war against COVID-19 is not yet won. All you have to do is look at what's happening in India these past couple weeks. They thought they had it under control, and now their hospitals are way over capacity. They're running out of even basic supplies like compressed oxygen. And right now we are using satellite thermal imaging to try to determine how many deaths there are so many. Closer to home, states including Michigan are seeing troubling fourth wave surges in COVID cases that threaten to harm more people and further disrupt economic activities. Here in the Commonwealth, this evil virus has now taken more than 6,500 of our neighbors, our friends, our fellow Kentuckians from us. That is a staggering loss. It's more than the number of Kentuckians lost in World War I, World War II, and Vietnam combined. And every single one of those 6,500 Kentuckians were children of God, irreplaceable, loved by their family and friends whose lives were cut short. While we still have a tough fight ahead of us and we have suffered these losses, feeling a very different emotion lately, and that's hope. More than 1.8 million Kentuckians have now been vaccinated. That is nothing short of a miracle. Think about our first case being 14 and a half months ago, and we have safe and effective vaccines. We're now over 50% of all of our adults vaccinated. We're over 80% of 65 and up Kentuckians vaccinated. Nothing short of a miracle. Other exciting development is our economy is growing, and we are prepared to thrive as we invest in the future and we emerge from this pandemic. And with us returning to our traditions with a great derby last week, we're well on our way to defeating COVID. We can see the light at the end of the tunnel, and it's been a dark tunnel, but it's getting brighter every day. This last Saturday, a beautiful sunny day, as the world watched, we showed that Kentucky is a leader and that we're willing to protect one another to save lives and to end this pandemic. We also were reminded about why people love to visit Kentucky, our hospitality, our food, our traditions, our culture, and our people. The world and the nation saw that Kentucky, which has faced this COVID crisis head on, is resilient. And we are emerging with a purpose and showing the world where we can go. I've said for months that we are prepared to emerge from this pandemic as a leader in the post-COVID economy to create thousands of good-paying jobs for our people. So just yesterday, we received incredibly encouraging news when Fitch, one of the big three credit rating agencies, upgraded its view on Kentucky's financial outlooks. Those folks scrutinized our finances, how we managed the pandemic, and the impact it had on our budget, and they moved our financial outlook up, stating that the Commonwealth's solid economic recovery from the pandemic, lower unemployment and more increases in employment, the way, and I'll talk about it in a minute, that we've managed our budget has us doing better than most of the country. And I'll tell you what, I got news from just today. I'm excited to tell you that later today, we're gonna announce that in April, it wasn't just the highest sales tax recorded since the pandemic, it's the highest in Kentucky's history, meaning we are having more goods purchased and more economic activity in this month of April through that indication than ever before. And that is not the only indication that this is happening. Folks, I'm telling you, it may take time for all of us to see it, but Kentucky's economy is starting to absolutely roar back. And I expect it to surpass where we were before this pandemic and continue to move forward. So these pieces of news, these outlooks, highlight how Kentucky's employment recovery through March has been slightly ahead of the national pace. Fitch's report notes significant progress in addressing our state pension contribution shortfalls and the fact that we're making the full actuarial contributions for all systems is making our outlook better and better. And not only did we end fiscal year 2020 with surpluses and an all-time high investment in a rainy day fund, but last week, we got a forecast for our third quarter economic and revenue report that indicated that our state would end the current fiscal year with an even larger surplus. Estimates suggest more than a $586 million surplus to our general fund and $12 million surplus in the road fund is gonna be actualized at the end of this fiscal year. So what that means is we'll end up with over $1 billion in our rainy day fund. That's the most money ever in the rainy day fund, either by raw dollars or as a percentage, meaning our house is in better financial and fiscal order than ever before. And I'm gonna continue to work hard to make sure we're always treating money for what it is. It's your money. Our tax dollars are your money. So the positive news is the fruit of putting politics aside when it came to defeating the coronavirus. It turns out that making decisions based on saving the most lives and being reasonable, following the science, listening to those around us, that's also the best way to safeguard our livelihoods and our economy. Think about it. When we stop fighting each other, when we don't worry about running for office multiple years out, we can do great things and we can get on track to be bigger and better than we ever have been before. So here in Kentucky, our response effort last summer also earned an analysis by Goldman Sachs, and this is a year ago. This is the first part of the pandemic. they found that our actions in Kentucky preserved a full 5% of our gross state product. That was more than a $10 billion savings, $10 billion that we would have lost had we not reacted the way we did. And even during the pandemic, this last year, we announced more than 270 economic development projects that are going to create more than 8,000 new jobs. The average pay is one of the highest in years. We at Site Selection Magazine, looking back at that last year, had us number one in our region in the South and number three nationally per capita in announcements that we made. Kentucky continued to shine. We supported our rural communities with more than $124 million in investment for 160 projects that are helping to diversify our regional economies. We distributed $1.6 billion in federal Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act funding. This included $40 million to create a food and beverage relief fund to help our local restaurants and bars that have been greatly impacted. And I've asked our legislature for more and will continue to do so. And now, more than 1.8 million Kentuckians, again, have received at least their first dose of the COVID-19 vaccine. And that's allowed us to start safely and sustainably, which is critical, easing public health restrictions over the past 2 months. In March, we increased capacity to 60% in most businesses. We also announced childcare facilities could return to traditional classroom group sizes. We've been able to shorten and simplify healthy at work minimum requirements. We've been able to loosen the mask mandate for smaller outdoor events. That's all because of you. And as more Kentuckians get vaccinated, it's going to be safer to lift even more restrictions. And we're going to have some more news on that tonight at 4. Thanks to the decisive actions that we've taken, but also the compassion of Kentuckians everywhere. And that includes civic, business, and community leaders, organizations, and industries that have done more than has ever been asked for them and did it sometimes without even being asked. And you see all of these folks making up Rotary's membership. We're getting Kentuckians vaccinated, and we're in far better shape than just about all of our neighboring states. That's in terms of both vaccinations, that's in terms of having lower per capita deaths, and it's in terms of how our economy is picking up compared to them. And while we're going to be gradually easing restrictions, once 2.5 million Kentuckians receive a vaccine, it's going to be safe to lift just about everything for nearly all venues, events, and businesses. It's going to be a really exciting time. As a result of the actions of our people, our policies, our priorities, economic momentum is building here in Kentucky. Like I said earlier, just last month, Site Selection Magazine placed Kentucky at the very top of the South Central region and third nationally for job creating projects in its annual Governor's Cup rankings. Commonwealth also placed seventh overall in total projects. That's not per capita, that is total projects, the highest of any state with a population under 5 million. What's happening here in Kentucky is big, and it's being noticed widely. In January, I was honored to be asked to co-chair the National Governors Association Economic Recovery and Revitalization Task Force. Leaders across the nation are eager to hear about how we, Kentucky, have managed the crisis. And I will tell you this last Saturday, the thing that I heard over and over from people from as far away as California or in Maine is that they have heard more about Kentucky in this last year, and they have been impressed, and they are now looking to us for opportunities that previously we weren't looked at. And again, just yesterday, Fitch upgrading its outlook on the Commonwealth is another clear signal that our economic fortunes are on the rise, and record sales tax collection just shows us exactly how primed our economy is getting. And that's even before our preparations to create more than 14,500 new jobs through a bipartisan agreement that actually happened, reached by lawmakers in my administration during the tail end of the 2021 regular session. Nearly $1.3 billion in American Rescue Plan Act funds are going to be used to boost our economy by expanding broadband, delivering clean drinking water, and building new schools. And for that brief period of time, and I hope it continues, everybody involved, that was myself and House and Senate leadership on both sides of the aisle, put politics aside. We had earnest discussions. We did the right thing. And now we can capitalize on this once in a lifetime opportunity to invest in our people and in our future. Working with Republican supermajorities in both chambers of the General Assembly was possible when we could drown out the noise and just look at what's best for our families. And the result, I believe, can be transformative. Think about providing clean drinking water to every Kentuckian, no matter where they live. Imagine running fiber or providing high-speed internet to every single home. Imagine rebuilding the literal building blocks of our schools and doing all of it without raising people's bills or raising their taxes. The bipartisan agreement also directs $575 million of the funds to repayment of a federal unemployment insurance loan. I know that's good news for business, and it's going to mean we were able to be there during this difficult time, providing record amounts of unemployment, record amounts to record amounts of people, ultimately being able to pay back the loan that was required in what, about a year and a half. We're also providing that $300 million to broadband deployment fund to begin addressing first the unserved communities. Combined with 50% matching funds from communities, think about how much we can do. More than $600 million just of state funds going towards broadband expansion in Kentucky, and the federal government just announced a lot more. Just the Kentucky piece is estimated to create over 10,000 direct and indirect jobs while providing equity in internet access, true opportunity. When we think about its importance in health, when we think about its importance in education, and when we think about its importance in business, this is the most important infrastructure we have, and it's got to be available to everybody. We're also providing $140 million to full-day kindergarten. My administration is an education-first administration. This is a key component, and a lot of school districts are now going to be able to provide pre-K as long as the full-day kindergarten funding continues. So education, it's the answer. It is the answer. It helps break cycles of poverty, and early childhood education is one of the best investments we can make for Kentucky's future. That building blocks of our schools, that's an extra $127 million for school construction and $75 million for renovation costs for local vocational schools, which are going to support building the well-trained workforce of the future. Now, in addition, clean drinking water, as I mentioned two or three times, it's just a human right. And surely in this country, we can be providing clean drinking water to every single home. So we've got $250 million from that bipartisan agreement for crucial upgrades to water and sewer infrastructure in communities across Kentucky. It creates jobs, and more importantly, provides the upgrades without increasing people's bills. All these projects mean one thing: good paying jobs for Kentuckians, better outlook for attracting businesses. But jobs, jobs right now, many thousands to meet the design, construction, and build out phases of these plans. And it's jobs in the future as improved infrastructure brings new investment, new growth, and new expansion. When I was speaking with you last year, I said it was our job to beat this virus on the very first try. Everything, all of our plans for the future, they still depend on that one great task. We must bring this pandemic to an end. And that means not giving up in the fourth quarter. Our ultimate victory is mere months away if we keep vaccinating people, staying ahead of dangerous variants, and working together to accomplish our bold plans. As tough as these past 14 months have been, the next 14 months can be some of the most exciting that we've ever seen. We can begin to reap the rewards of our sacrifices and our investments, and make no mistake, one of the reasons these investments are coming here is how we have managed this pandemic, that we have worked with each and every community, that we have made wise decisions, that we have pushed politics aside, that we have eased into difficulty, and we are going to ease out of it. Now is when we surge to ultimate victory over COVID, and then we buckle up. We take off, and we take our place as a leader in the post-COVID economy. Folks, Kentucky's time is now. It is right now. I encourage you to help me, to work with me. Let's grasp this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. When the economy is going to be wide open, when COVID creates a new playing field where Kentucky can be at the very top. Let's make this Commonwealth everything we always dreamed of. Thank you. God bless. Happy to take questions.
Oh, thank you so much, Governor. We so appreciate you being here and your bold leadership. There's a few questions here. They're kind of in categories, so I'll go ahead and start with one. You're hearing a lot about workforce and the need for workers. So this question comes from a Rotarian. Next week, the work search requirement for those on unemployment is being reinstated. Thank you for moving that forward. However, there is a requirement only to show proof of one contact per week. Why are the work search requirements not being fully reinstated to pre-COVID levels?
So the work requirements are stated in a different way, but we checked into this. They are going to be, ultimately, when you look at what's required, what they were for pre-COVID levels. But you know where we are right now is unquestionably, folks have jobs open and they're ready for people to come back to work. And listen, I praise each and every one of you for that. We're excited to fill them. And we've got two things that we're dealing with. I know one is folks have been on unemployment. They've been worried about their kids. They've had to do virtual learning. And then the other is fear for health and safety. Obviously, the vaccines and where we are right now is going to satisfy a lot of it. So we want to work with you. We want to work with you to get people back to work. And we know there are a lot of drivers for that. And we want to talk through each and every one of them. I also believe that naturally, we are starting to see a curve with more and more people ready to go back to work. Remember, when we were able to open our schools. It's one where we were the very first state to prioritize our teachers. And once we got that done, once we got people vaccinated, you heard me say we didn't do this for nothing. And we got them back open faster than most every state. And with the exception of two that have had to go virtual in the last several days, showing we are not out of the woods yet, I expect us to be in a good place for our schools through the end of the year. So I believe we're going to see continued improvement. But I will say, if the economic development activity that I'm seeing bears out, we're going to need more and more people in our workforce even than before this pandemic. So we've got to think about not just how to get people back, but how to get more people in, because I was looking at a project the other day that could create up to 6,000 jobs. I mean, that'd be phenomenal. We'd all want that one.
Yes, absolutely. So can you share what some of the bright spots and some of the sectors that are in demand that you're finding as you're doing economic development?
Well, we're seeing demand across. We've seen a great opportunity from pharmaceutical. We're seeing a lot of interest in electrification, manufacturing picking up. Our aluminum sector is just going nuts in Kentucky. I mean, in every single part with the number and groups coming in. We see suppliers for major folks that we've landed, like Nucor, showing a lot of interest in moving in. App Harvest is creating its own gravity in Eastern Kentucky, our newest publicly traded company and probably the leader in agritech right now in our entire country, and it's happening in Eastern Kentucky. We're seeing, thankfully, interest in solving some of our resiliency issues through this pandemic. PPE suppliers looking at moving in, knowing that we need to have those local contracts, not even just national contracts, but to be ready to not face this anymore. Car sales are also through the roof right now. We think we're gonna have the best month in terms of the tax collection on motor use that we've ever seen as well. But I truly think our economic rebound is going to be in just about all sections. Now, hospitality is going to take a little longer. And I understand people talking about capacity, and we're going to gradually ease that. Our challenge is going to be as much confidence as capacity. And I truly believe, again, we eased into things. If we ease out, you will see that confidence build. And the way we do it is going to help with that.
Very good. This question relates to infrastructure. Will we receive federal funds to upgrade our bridges, roads, and so many other areas that we have, we need support?
Well, first, we all know that there is, it's not a bill yet, but a at least discussion and a plan in front of Congress that could revolutionize, transform our infrastructure, could help us with decades of insufficient funding, could help us with mega projects like the Brent Spence Bridge that we desperately need to repair, supplement, and or replace whatever gets us there that again, that local community can support, I can be behind. But it's also time that we do what's necessary to boost our own transportation budget. I've been for it. I've been willing to step out on it. I think we were there to get it through the House, and then at the last minute, the Senate balked. We pushed, and we need those that are supportive of this to push even harder, but to push at the place that every year, it seems, it continues to fail to get through. And we've got to change when we look at the future. Electrification is coming real fast. It's going to come faster than any of us ever anticipated. GM talked about in 15 years, they think every single one of their cars may be electric. If that's the case, we gotta start thinking really critically about, first of all, how we build out that infrastructure, whether it's charging stations or replacement batteries, two different technologies, both with advantages and disadvantages. But then how we maintain our roads when nobody's buying gas. So the future's coming real fast, and that's exciting to me, but it's going to require us to make bold decisions.
And in regards to health, beyond COVID, is your administration working on anything specific healthcare issues that you'd want to share with us?
Well, first, to everybody in the healthcare industry that's here with the Rotary, thank you. Oh my goodness, thank you. You look at a place like Kentucky where one of the things holding us back the most has been our health, being number one, two, or three in heart disease, lung cancer, diabetes. We should have been ground zero for death in this pandemic. We should have been. Everything that you see about COVID-19, it attacks the conditions that unfortunately we are far too unhealthy in. But through a combination of compassion for one another, really sacrifices for people, protecting other people. I think strong decisions we made here in state government, not always popular, but then incredible work through our healthcare industry. Guess what? We have some of the lowest per capita death rates in the country, but that's not resiliency. Resiliency means we've got to get healthier. And part of that is access. So we've done a number of different things that ought to boost access. We have increased the dispensing fee for our independent pharmacies. That's going to help them thrive and make sure that we don't have them shutting down, especially in rural Kentucky. We've been able to increase Medicaid payments to especially hospitals across Kentucky that are going to make finances work for rural hospitals and other systems in really positive ways. In the midst of the pandemic, I ended up settling about a 15-year-old lawsuit because we knew that the federal government would chip in and we could get dollars flowing to those groups as quickly as possible. But these changes in reimbursement ought to make the economics work to get our healthcare in to areas that are underserved. We know that access is the most important thing, getting someone to see a doctor regularly. And we've got to make sure that we have facilities in difficult to reach communities where there are transportation issues. We need to continue to increase telehealth. We've been pushing hard during the pandemic on Medicaid, and we'll want to transfer people into private pay as we come out of it, but more people covered than ever before. And the K-CHIP program is important. You know, we can think all different things about healthcare, and I don't think too much about how it's structured or getting to the national debates. I just want everybody to be able to see a doctor and for it not to bankrupt them to do so. So as we think about, you know, our differences, let's all come together with every child needs to be covered in some form or fashion. And that's investment into our K-CHIP program to make sure everybody gets that healthy start and shot at life.
Yes, and this last group of questions, Governor, we know of your commitment to children. Can you touch a little bit about education and how the federal stimulus money will be directed? Will it support elementary and secondary education? And then secondly, what the plan is for accelerating student learning that was lost during this post-COVID era?
There are hundreds of millions of dollars coming into our education system. That's both public, and we have a program for private schools too. That's part of the GEAR, Governor's Education Funding. First round, I think it's about $40 million. That's going out right now. There's good work being done by private schools that this is going to help them. Public schools, hundreds of millions of dollars coming in. Ought to help us begin with addition to broadband, breaking that digital divide, reaching each and every student. You know, I once heard a governor about 8 years ago. I was watching C-SPAN. Yes, I'm a guy that watched C-SPAN. Say, if you give me a tree stump and a book, I can teach a kid anything. Not in this economy, not in this world. The technology has changed so much. The way we go about things has changed so much. We cannot let our kids be behind in any of those pieces. I hope we're also going to use these dollars to think about what a post-COVID or our current world, what a classroom ought to look like, because so much has changed and we've got to be at the forefront. What I want to see in education and increasing our acceleration is every child on a path. And we don't have to choose the path for them, but every child should be either on a four-year college degree path. And let me be clear, we need more four-year graduates of our universities if we want to compete with certain other states for certain opportunities. You know, there are a lot of politicians who will say not every kid needs to go to college. And while that's true, we need a whole lot more to go to college. So we are providing more funding than ever before. Right now, we can fill the gap for every two-year degree, and they can flip that over to the four-year degree, but we need more paths. Either the four-year path, the two-year associate's degree path, or a certificate or a vocational path. We need every single child that is on one of those clear career paths and to support them. And they need to be able to switch between paths too, either when they're going through their education or later. Those paths always need to be open. So taking an associate's degree and turning it in to a BA or BS, being able to take your vocational certificate and already have credits if you want to go get that associate's degree. We got to make all that more possible, but we ultimately have to do more, and we have to do better, and we need more educational achievement than ever before. I will say our lieutenant governor is a huge advantage here. Actually, having watched kids fall through cracks at different places along that spectrum, we have more symbiotic activities or initiatives going between KDE, CPE, and her cabinet than ever before. And it's got to be that one continuum. So I worry a lot that, you know, we got a lot of bureaucracy in Frankfurt. That's just how it's created. I got a lot of independent agencies that we have to work with. I have a lot of cabinets. We do a lot of things. But our people shouldn't feel that bureaucracy. They ought to be able to get streamlined services. That's the same thing with education. Just because different groups, different universities, different systems, school systems have a part in it, we need to make sure that it is seamless for those that are going through it so that our bureaucracy doesn't stand in the way of success.
Governor, thank you so very much for being with us today. We're just so delighted to spend some time with you and hear more about your vision and the good work that you're leading. And just again, thank you so much. I don't know if you can feel the applause. It's hard in these kind of Zoom meetings, but it's resounding. So thank you so much. And Bill Wilson is joining me in leading this today. And Bill's the president of the Lexington Club. And we have people from all over the state that have joined us as well. So we all just salute you. We thank you. And we want to share to all Rotarians, be well. And thank you so much for being with us today. We are adjourned.